computer architecture makes assembly the second part of functions. Let's see how this works. Last lecture, I left you with this program here on the left that was just printing numbers from 0 until 9, if you remember. If not, just go back to the previous lecture about functions. This is going to be the second part, because there can be a problem arising. Namely, if this program that we have here, the main program, is calling the function, and this function is using the same registers as the main part is using. So imagine that my function here would use T0 and T1, and they're also used here. That means that the values will be overwritten, and maybe upon returning from this function, this registers T0 and T1, they no longer have their correct values, and the entire loop can get messed up, so to say. Just to give you an example, imagine that instead of just printing numbers, we want to print the square of the number. So we have to do, actually, before we do all this, we have to do some kind of multiplication. And just to make the thing work bad, I'm going to use the variables that are up there. So let's do that. Multiply. Where do we have our information? Well, it is in V0. There we got our... In A0, sorry. In A0 we got our argument. That was the number to print. And we're going to put A0, multiply A0 with A0. And because of that, and the result will be put in T0. So we have now T0, we have the square of the argument. And don't forget, T0 is also being used by the start loop, by the loop here in the main function. I hope you see that this can go wrong, because now imagine we start here with, or at a certain time we have in T0 we have 2, so this is I equals 2, and then here this one will be multiplied actually by 2, so it will be 4. So this loop will go from 0, 1, 4, etc. That is not what we wanted. So we have to do something about that. Now, before I show you this, I want to mess up this loop here even a little bit more. I want to use another variable, just for fun, and later you will understand what I'm meaning. Instead of using T, we're going to use S. So that means we're going to have T1, we're going to use S1. So it's in principle it should do exactly the same. But now, this program, I hope you understand, I'm not even going to run it. Well, it will compile, I hope. Yes, it compiles. But this program will not run correctly, because it's messing here with this loop variables, loop registers. So this thing will, I will not even going to try it, because maybe the thing will crash. So what are we going to do? Well, for this purpose, exactly for this purpose, we have the stack. On the stack you can temporarily store things, and then later when you come back from the function, you can recover these things. And the things to recover, to put there and to recover, would be the registers that you're still going to use, T0 and S1. So, how are we going to do that? How does this stack work? Well, on the stack, you can place an item by pushing and by popping. And I made here for you a nice image. That is, you have somewhere in memory that is not conventional memory, that is not heap memory. Heap memory you can access any way you like, any element you like, as long as you know the address. On the stack, you can only access the last element of the stack. And just to remind you, this stack pointer that we have here is register number 29, so it is part of the MIPS entire architecture. So in the beginning, imagine there is nothing on the stack, it's empty. Then we're going to push T0 on the stack. So now the stack consists of T0, and the stack pointer has changed by the amount of the size of this element, which is a normal register is 4 bytes, as you know. And then we're going to push T1, or actually S1, I should have put here S1, we're going to push on the stack. T0 we have now, and we have T1 on the stack. And when we want to recover them, then of course we can pop them, but we will always pop the last one, which will be S1. Oh, I completely messed this up. We have to read this one as S1 and we pop S1, so the remaining element of the stack will be T0, and the stack pointer has now again been adjusted here, and we can pop the last element from the stack, and the stack will again be empty, and the stack pointer will point to the bottom of the stack. So how do we do this? We're going to do pushing and popping instructions. They don't exist in MIPS, but we can easily implement it ourselves. First we add -4 to the stack pointer, and then we store the word, the thing that we want. And when we are doing popping, we first load the word from the stack, and then we add 4 to the stack pointer. And don't forget, the first one that is added to the stack is the last one that has to be popped off the stack. It is so-called LIFO or LIFO, last in, first out. Or as you know, and you can also call it FILO, first in, last out. So let's see how we're going to do this here. We have to put S1 and T0 on the stack. Okay, T0 and S0. But where are we going to do this? Who is going to do this administration of putting things on the stack? Is it by name code, or is it a function? Okay, now we have the rule that the S registers have to be administrated by the function, which we call the callee, the one that is being called, and the T registers must be saved in the stack by the program that is calling the function. Okay, so here we have the main function. One is going to call my function. This one has to place T0 on the stack. How did we do that? Let me again show this here on this slide here. Part of the lecture note, don't forget to read them. Everything is in there. Add immediate stack pointer. Stack pointer -4. So we added 4. We are actually decreasing the stack. It goes from top to bottom. It's a little bit inverted of the image, but the idea is the same. So now we can do store word. Which one? T0. Where to put it? Exactly 0 offset from the stack pointer. And then when we come back, actually, the first thing to be done has to be to replace them, to recover this item from the stack. But now let's see, we're going into the function. So the first thing the function has to do is putting the one it's going to use here. Oh, it's not going to use anything. That is nice. So this one is not going to use any S register, so it doesn't have to save any S register. That is nice. Otherwise it would have to put things here on the stack here. Has to be done placing on the stack, pushing to the stack the register that it is going to use. But it's not going to use any S register, so it doesn't have to do doesn't have to do anything. This one, however, also doesn't have to push S registers on the stack, because that is none of his business. He couldn't care less, so to say. But the T register has to be recovered from the stack, T0. So how do we do this? Let me look here. We first do a load word. Load word. What are we going to load into? We're going to load it into T0. Where are we going to load it from? From 0 offset from the stack pointer. And then don't forget to add immediate stack pointer 4. Now, in principle, is it like, oh, but I don't know, maybe this the one that's writing this code, maybe I should also save S on the stack. Well, if you want, you can do this, but you should have confidence that the one that's writing the functions will also be a good programmer, just like yourself. And you have to remember that good programmers, if it is a function being called a function and it's going to use S registers, the function, the one that's being called, has to place the things on the stack. Otherwise, it's not needed. And this one can have full confidence that the S registers will not change by the function call. So now I hope that this one works. Let's see if it compiles, let's see if I made any errors. I think this should now work and we should get the numbers from, we should have the square number. No, it will not give the square numbers because we have to, of course, we have to place the for the system call, we have to place the calculated number into a zero. Otherwise it will print just zero. So in this case, we have copied the just calculated value, the square of the argument, and we place this now as an argument into the system call 1. Let's see if it compiles. Yes, it compiles. And let me run it. Yes, as you see, well, the output is a little bit messy, but you can see 0 square, 1 square, 2 square, 3 square, 4 square, 5 square, etc. So let me resume once again. You have to be careful that the registers that you're still going to need that have to be placed on the stack somehow to temporarily save them. You push them on the stack by an add immediate -4 to the stack pointer, then store the item that you want to put on the stack, and after the function call, the first thing that the program should do is recover the registers from the stack. See you in the next lecture.